skinny love just last a year. Poor little soul, we were never here.
Mommy, you're always cooking.
My mind. Staring at the sink of blood and crushed veneer.
Come on, skinny love just last a year. Poor little soul, we were never here. My mind. Staring at the sink of blood and crushed veneers.
Daddy passed away, and it ain't been the same since. Mama tried to talk to me about love, but I can't comprehend.
Your first on biggest bullshit, man. My you dropped 28 today, man. So I take meds, came out like I got a chip on your shoulder, man.
What you know about the struggle? Seven in a room, we was sleeping on each other. Dirty clothes on top of us, cause we ain't even have no cover. Lonely nights, mama was sick, I just prayed for recovery.
I am Tyree Crump, and I'm from Bainbridge, Georgia.
Going towards Vanderbilt's basket.
He missed them both. It's tipped around. Georgia's got it loose. They're going to have a chance. Deep three. At the corner. Oh! And Georgia wins it. Oh, Tyree Crump for the win of the world.
What motivated me to become a basketball player was the environment I grew up in. It was either the streets or sports. So I chose the sports instead of the streets. I started playing basketball at the age of, I'd say, 11 years old. Growing up in Bainbridge, Georgia, man, Bainbridge is a trap. Not was, it still is. Sometimes, man, when I go home, it's hard to leave because of the people, you know what I'm saying? Like, I'm a people's person. I'm a people's champ. Like, people love me. People attract me. And, like, you know, especially the people that I grew up with, you know, all my guys. If I'm being honest, all my guys, you know, they didn't make it to go to college. So they pushed me. You know, it's a trap for real. It's really nothing but the streets. It's a small town, and if you don't play sports, you ain't gonna make it out unless you got a degree and you went to college and got a good job. But other than that, you're not making it out. It's that simple. That's why we call it the trap. Cause you're not gonna make it out. Like, there's no ends but if you don't play sports, you're not making it out. Simple. I had a lot of support system when it come behind that basketball stuff. But when it just came down to just, you know, just if I needed anything, like clothes, money, if I needed to drive the car, whatever I need, gas, whatever, they made sure that happened. If I needed to get to AU practice, they made sure that happened. Whatever. If my mama couldn't do it, they made sure that happened. I lost my father. I never met him. He got killed. He got shot 9 times before I was born, a couple months before I was born. So that left my mama stranded with me by herself to take care of me alone. He got killed March 29th. Just growing up without him, it was tough because I would always, like, just hear all these stories. Like, every time I would go somewhere, it'd always be, you look just like your daddy. You look just like your daddy. Oh boy, your daddy used to do this. Oh boy, your daddy used to do that. Or it was always, I was just like, damn, like, you know, like, I wonder how it would have been if I actually had my daddy in my life, you know? And like he was actually here to witness this, you know? People even telling me, like, my dad used to wear so much Tommy Hilfiger back in the day, like, when he died, they shut the cleaners down because he used to come there so much, and they made this big Tommy Hilfiger balloon because he used to come to the like every Friday and spend like over $500-$600 just on clothes. But yeah, my dad got shot 9 times at his own party actually. He threw a party before his birthday. His birthday was April 13th. His birthday was coming up, you know, it's around Easter. And he threw a party and he got into it with actually one of his friends. It started at a basketball court, you know, him and his friend got into it and they got to fighting. And it escalated to the club that night. And And they end up, you know, fighting at the club again, and they shot my daddy 9 times. I actually don't have a conversation with the guy, you know, who actually shot my dad. If we being real, if I'm being real with you, like, he wasn't the one that even killed my daddy. He just took the blame for everything. Like, it was more than one gun that was shot, and his gun was not the one that killed my daddy. He actually shot my daddy in the leg. So, no, I don't hold no grudges. Like, we never had a conversation about that, you know, that particular incident that happened. But he was always supportive of me. He would always come to the games. You know, he'd been out for a while, so, you know, he would always come to the games. Or every time he saw me, he was like, man, I see you. Keep going. Keep doing your thing, you know. But I could just always tell, like, you know, he always wanted to say, like, man, you look like your daddy. Like, but you know how it go. Like, even where I'm from, my daddy is a legend. My father was a people person. He was a people champ. He was a man in the streets, you know. He did what he did in the streets. And sometimes, you know, like, it come back on you, even though you're a good person. That come back on you.
We were sleeping on each other, dirty clothes on top of us, cause we ain't even have no cover. Lonely nights, mama was sick, I just prayed for recovery. But that ain't stop shit. Looked up to them older niggas that were selling crack at Knicks. Couldn't even get no hoes, cause I was rocking shit with Fitz. Cold world, real story, man. This ain't
so when I was old enough to understand that I didn't have my father, I had to grow up early. I had to be the man of the house early. I am the only child. My mother didn't want to have any more kids. After my father passed away, she's battling a disease called lupus. So, you know, just waking up every day knowing that, you know, it's a possibility that I may could lose her because of that disease that pushed me to go harder. We actually moved to Atlanta when I was in the fourth grade. We actually moved here when I was in the fourth grade. We left when I was in the fifth grade because she got really, 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 really sick, you know. And we moved back to Bainbridge. And I was amazed on, like, how someone can just get so sick like that just out of nowhere. Because I didn't know what it was at the time, you know. So my mom was just, like, slowly doing things that she normally wouldn't do. Like, she would just, like, say stuff that just didn't make sense. And me, I'm like, you know, mom, that don't make sense. I wouldn't tell her that, but I was like, okay, that don't make sense. And she just started doing stuff that she normally wouldn't do. So one day, you know, I woke up and she was just laying there, like, she couldn't move. She was throwing up. She was just sick, she couldn't eat. And it went down here from there. My mama went from weighing like, she went from weighing like 155 to like 80 pounds. Sit by the bed for hours, just looking at her, you know, and just praying for that, you know, like, whatever you do, just don't take my mother away from me, you know what I mean? First, it's my grandma Brynn, you know, that's my mom, mother. That's who I used to live with when my mom was sick. That's who we lived with, my grandma. Grandma Brynn, she always did the impossible, you know. She made sure, like, you know, even if it was her last, you know, if it was light bill money or anything, she made sure, like, I had stuff for school, whether it was shoes or clothes. When my mama went down, Grandma, she used to always be, she used to be tough on me. So I used to be like, man, I ain't finna stay over here. I'm about to go with my other grandma high. Me and my cousin, he used to steal a car and put it back before she wake up. We already knew what time she was gonna wake up. She wake up at a certain time. She wake up at 12:30 every night to take a mess. So we steal a car before 12, bring it back. By the time she call our name, we'll be back in there. Man, you do what you want. That's why I wanted to be. I was over there with Grandma Betty. All she do is talk trash and cuss you out all day. And that's what I liked. You know, I just sometimes just get on the nerve just so I can hear just fuss and cuss. My first success in basketball was going to the super sophomore camp in high school. I went to the camp. I'm a guy from a small city, so nobody knew me. And I think we played Eric Gordon, little brother. I can't remember his name, but at the time he was ranked number one in the nation, and I was nobody. And I ended up having like 28 points on him, played pretty solid defense. And I blew up after that.
You had a little battle going on with Aaron Gordon, man. Talk about that a little bit, man. Did you like seek him out? You know who the kid is beforehand?
Yeah, they say Eric Gordon, one of the top players in the nation. So I was just like, all right, I'm gonna guard him, and everybody gonna know me. I thought he'd done the guard. So I just played the bar, and tried to score.
Best basketball game I ever played was in high school. I'll never forget, we played Worth County. I had 55 points. Tough environment to play in. You know, it's a small gym. And I had a great game, 55. What's so crazy was, I would sleep on the bus on the way to the game, and I woke up and seen the number 55, not even knowing that that's how many points I was about to score. It's crazy. Like I told you, I'm from a small town, so too many people don't get the opportunities to even go D1, high D1, or D1 straight out of high school. So every game sold out. Like, you couldn't even, if you didn't get that JV, you wouldn't get in. Like, even when I go to the barbershop, oh, come on, we coming to see you tonight. Well, how many points are you going to get? Like, they were just excited just to even like, have, you know, like even come to the game, because they knew like I was big. And then like, we used to have like, my buddy, my cousin Jordan Harris. Like, he was my best friend. He's my best friend. He also my cousin. Like he committed to Georgia too. Like we committed together. And he was 15 minutes away from me in Iron City, Georgia. So like when we played each other, crazy. Like it was crazy. Like the fans used to be going crazy. I'm talking about like I never seen no high school games like this. Like still to this day, no high school games wasn't like my high school, me and his high school game. I remember we played each other, I believe it was my sophomore year. I remember I had went to the barbershop and people were like, yeah, man, you know, Joy finna come out here and he finna do all this to you, do all this to you. I never really said too much. You know, I never really spoke on it. You know, I was just like, all right. You know, I soak all that in because I'm a competitor. And Jordan popped up at my house because we just had played him. I was about to play him at my hometown. So he popped up. He popped up at my house and he was like, bro, what's up? I'm like, how you get here? How the hell you get here? Like that. And he was like, man, I'm going to ride to the game with you. I'm like, okay. The whole time, he don't even know. I'm just thinking about how I'm finna kill like this game. Like I can't lose this game, you know, like that. We got there. I could hear the fan like Crump. They call him a name. I could hear him, but I got my headphones. I'm ignoring him because I don't want to talk to nobody, especially not before the game.
We just got to get better in some areas. We tried to make plays that wasn't there. That's why we got up to a slow start. I think we just got to go in practice and we got to be better than we ever was. We see what we got to work on and we got to take it into practice and be better than we ever was.
Georgia was my dream school growing up. All my families was UGA fans. All we watched was dogs every Saturday, every Sunday, whenever they played. That's all we watched. So, you know, I always told my family that I'm gonna go to Georgia. And some laughed, some believed. It ended up happening. So I'm proud to say that I'm a dog.
It was about 2 years ago I walked in that gym and met Tyree Crump. Me and Tyree met through mutual friends. We were in the lab over in Stone Mountain, Georgia. We got some work in, and since that first workout, man, we've been every single day since then. First thing that stood out when I walked in that gym, he brings an incredible energy, and that's why I love being around him. The way he works, the way he approaches every single day, whether it's preparing for his body, whether it's the food he puts in his body, whether it's how he treats the other guys I'm bringing in the gym. It's inspiring to be around, and that's why, shoot, we've been doing this for 2 years nonstop, day in, day out, morning, nights, midday, doesn't matter. If Tyree Crump calls me, I'm in that lab with him.
What about the rules? Parameters.
Let's go fun.
You take the beating for the friend, you don't run, you don't lay down, you don't patrol. Yeah. My brother Gene, Joey, the big, they don't roll. He's doing 1,000 years now, they don't roll.
No, they don't rap coming. White, that's the rule. Don't stop this shit. Basic rules.
We missed the bubble with us on.
Ever.
Oh, shit, I thought that was it.
Oh, God.
Did anyone?
They don't right here.
Anyone. Anywhere.
We missed the bubble with his off. We done came a long way from having gas in the jar. Stuffing peas in the seat while you riding in the car. And don't get caught by cheat, they lurking, you know them dogs gonna bark. And if you middle man, that's cool, don't trudge it. Always play your part. Always keep that swing.
The intangible that I see with Tyree Crump that stands out from the other guys that I work with, you know, I've been around a lot of pro guys, quite a few NBA guys, and top high school guys, is the energy he brings into every single workout and how he uplifts every kid around him. He makes a workout better when he walks in it. He makes a team better when he walks in that locker room. And, you know, you can't beat that. That's, you know, that's something you can't teach. And I think every coach that ever coached him would say the exact same thing.
I may shoot 500 to 1,000 jumpers every day. Sometimes I get in the gym twice when I want to shoot 1,000. When I want to shoot 1,000 shots, I get in the gym twice. It's kind of hard to shoot 1,000 jumpers at one go time. So I break it down to 500 one session, 500 next session, and then I go up to 1,000. Or it just depends on what I'm working. Sometimes I just work on finishing at the rim, floaters, just little things. If my trainer sees something that, you know, that I'm slacking in, we'll work on that, whether it's footwork or just the little things.
You know, he makes you, as a coach that's, you know, working with kids nonstop every day, I get excited about walking in the gym with Tyree Crump, because I know this is his life and this is what he wants to do for the rest of his life, and how dedicated and how passionate and how much he loves this game is inspiring to be around, and it's been a pleasure. He's been a guy that people have doubted these past 2 years. You know, it's been a kind of a rocky path after Georgia, and, you know, that's when I talk about the energy that he has, it's channeled from that chip that he has every time he walks in the court, that chip that he knows people are sleeping on.
I want to win. That's my biggest goal whenever I'm competing versus anybody. I just want to win, no matter how, what it took to get there. I just want to win. So, what made Tyree the winner is he going to be the same person every day, no matter what. He going to always try to find a solution to every problem he have. He gonna always keep going, no matter the situation he in or what he been through. He gonna always keep pushing, gonna figure it out. That's what made me a winner. But I learned that, you know, over time, you can't always play to the crowd, you know. Yeah, I learned how to be, you know, I always been coachable, but I like to give fans a show. I want them to come back and be like, man, I enjoy watching you play. You know, I want to continue to come back and watch you play. So every time I'm on the court, I'm always gonna put on a show or put on entertainment or talk to the crowd or show the crowd some love. Just, you know, maybe whether it's just pointing at them or, you know, just smiling or dapping them up. You know, I'm always gonna give fans love. I'm always gonna entertain the crowd for sure. I don't really have a dream team. I just wanna get there, and whatever team that I play for, and that's what it be. I just want to get there. No matter what people tell you, your dreams can be accomplished. No matter what the environment you grow up in, be who you are. Never try to fit in. Never be no yes man. Never be second to no one. You be who you are. And if people around you can't accept you for who you are, then you just move around. What you've been through in your life or what you're going through in your life, if you keep working, you can make it. Some things you can't control. You gotta control what you can control. But like when adversity hit, I just pray. I just ask God to just, you know, put me in a situation, put me in the right state of mind to get through this adversity. And it always overpassed.
Thank you. skinny low just last a year. Poor little soul, we were never here. My, staring at the sink of blood and crushed veneers.